Hello, and welcome to this video on managing iSCSI storage in Oracle Linux Virtualization Manager. In this video, we will introduce basic storage concepts implemented by Oracle Linux Virtualization Manager, list the requirements for using iSCSI storage with Oracle Linux Virtualization Manager, demonstrate the steps for adding iSCSI storage. Oracle Linux Virtualization Manager uses storage domains to hold the resources used by virtual machines. These virtual machine resources include disk images, ISO files, templates, and snapshots. Storage domains are defined by the storage interfaces associated with particular storage types. Supported storage types can be file-based storage like NFS or Network File System, or other POSIX-compliant file systems. On these file-based storage domains, all virtual machine resources are implemented as files. Oracle Linux Virtualization Manager also supports block-based storage types like iSCSI or Internet Small Computer System Interface, and FCP, or Fiber Channel Protocol Storage. In these block-based storage domains, virtual machine resources are implemented as logical volumes. You can also use locally attached storage for storage domains. Resources stored on locally attached disks are available to the host to which they are attached. It's important to remember that if a host is attached to local storage, it gets placed into its own private cluster, and a host can only belong to one cluster. This means migration functions are not possible for this host as it cannot be associated with any other hosts. Remember, to be able to create and maintain storage domains, you should be familiar with the supported storage technologies, including the storage products that use them. One important note to mention is that you cannot initialize a data center without an activated storage domain attached to it. Before creating an iSCSI storage domain, ensure that your environment contains at least two systems running Oracle Linux. One system acts as the manager and the other is your KVM host. You also need an iSCSI server accessible to both the manager and the KVM hosts with configured targets and LUNs. When adding an iSCSI storage domain, you perform a discovery, so you need to know the fully qualified name or IP address of the iSCSI server. To perform an iSCSI login, you also need the target ID and initiator name of the LUN to use. Okay, so now let's use the administration portal to create an iSCSI storage domain. After logging in, I'm taken to the dashboard. The environment contains three KVM hosts and one active storage domain. I click the Data Storage Domains link in the box near the top of the page. The Storage Domains page displays. The only active storage domain listed is for NFS file storage. To create and attach a new storage domain, click the New Domain button. In the New Domain dialog window, from the four configuration options on the left, I first click the Data Center dropdown and select the data center name to which we will attach this storage domain. We can choose any of the data centers available. For this demonstration, I will attach it to the default data center. The second option is the Domain function. Clicking its dropdown, we have three choices: Data, ISO, and Export. Here we select Data, as this new domain will function as a data domain because it will contain the virtual disk files and virtual appliances for all virtual machines and templates. An ISO domain holds the ISO files used by the virtual machines to boot and install their operating systems. Export domains are the third option. If I wanted to copy or move images between data centers in my environment, I would store them in an export domain. Clicking the Storage Type dropdown, we select iSCSI. This causes a Discover Targets dialog box to open. The New Domain dialog box automatically displays any known targets with unused LUNs under the target name column. The last option is which host to use. The dropdown menu will list the available hosts. Here we will take the displayed host OVS037. The new storage domain requires a name. I will paste in the name iSCSI-data-domain for this demonstration. In order to display the available targets, you need to discover them. In the Discover Targets address field, we can enter a fully qualified domain name or IP address of this iSCSI host on the storage array. Here I paste in the address I want to use, 10.196.210.62. For the port field, we enter the port to connect to on the host when we're browsing for targets. By default, this field is automatically populated with the default iSCSI port of 3260. Ticking the user authentication checkbox allows us to authenticate with the storage using a CHAP username and password, but for this environment, it's not needed. With my information set, I click Discover. The target name column updates to list all the available targets discovered on the storage array. Scrolling down the target name column, I select the desired target and select the black right directional arrow beside the name to log into the target. The storage domains list refreshes to now only list the targets for the address which we logged into. We click the plus sign button beside our target to expand the desired target. It expands to display all the unused LUNs. For the second of the two listed, I click Add for the LUN ID that is to connect to the target. I get a warning message that this card is not supported because this target is on a ZFS storage system. This is because I forgot to uncheck the discard after delete option in the advanced parameters, which is required when using ZFS storage. So let's uncheck that box now. Clicking the plus button beside advanced parameters, it expands to show the options. I uncheck the discard after delete box and can now click OK. This closes the new domain dialog and refreshes the storage domains list. We now see the new domain with our selected name added to the list. As the storage domain is set up, we can see the cross data center status changing from unattached to locked. We can click tasks to monitor the various processing steps that are completed to attach the iSCSI data domain to the data center. And after a few minutes, the tasks show complete status, and we can click close to return to the storage domains list. The cross data center status now shows active. With the iSCSI data domain now added to our virtualization environment, we can upload the resources that are used by the virtual machines. In this video, we introduced basic storage concepts implemented by Oracle Linux Virtualization Manager, listed the requirements for using iSCSI storage with Oracle Linux Virtualization Manager, demonstrated the steps for adding iSCSI storage, and explored the storage domain directory structure. Oracle provides an extensive number of resources which you can use to find out more about this subject and others. You can find documentation on Oracle Linux Virtualization Manager at the link shown. There is a comprehensive Oracle Linux curriculum available to support a full range of Linux administration skills for cloud, on-premise, and hybrid users. For more information, or to get started on Oracle Cloud Infrastructure, go to cloud.oracle.com. And for more training on Linux on Oracle Cloud Infrastructure, go to the link shown here. That's the end of the video. Thanks for watching.